I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Open your mind. Exercise your imagination. This week, Bill S. Ballinger's study of a deadly obsession. Fourth of Forever. Starring John Dehner. And Susan Oliver. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Ford Motor Company, Wrigley Gum, and Sign-Off. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
This week, a story of numbers. One man, one woman, and the desperation of their individual single desires. James Marius, freewheeler, habitual gambler, chronic loser. Lou Jackson, mysterious, feline, alluring. Two people among millions who meet in the sprawling metropolitan basin that is Los Angeles, California. A chance meeting, with the odds locked in, to murder. First, a proposition to follow a man and his money for the purpose of separating the two. Second, a guarantee of favorable circumstance and lucrative just rewards. Third, a choice to share the profit or split the loss. Fourth of Forever will begin following this word. Picture this. A little used airstrip in a mountainous part of Mexico. Nothing more than a few hundred feet of cleared land. Enough for a skilled pilot to set down a small plane on. A handful of men flank the runway, their eyes to the sky. A small two-engine plane. And one man alone in the cockpit.
With one of the two engines missing, my old plane was wavering in the still air. I felt her tremble through the stick in my hands as I circled over the landing strip of that miserable, desolate little field. What really worried me was the cargo, the heavy drilling machines lashed in the plane just behind my neck. I cursed myself for taking the contract to deliver the stuff in the first place. Money can force a man to do a lot of things against his will. The lack of money can make him do even more. The machinery was still lashed tight, and I had to get down fast. It was now or never. I went in. The plane was overloaded. The old undercarriage couldn't take it. It went. And then a wing dug, furrowed into the ground. And over she somersaulted with the cargo tearing free, and all hell broke loose.
Incendio! Incendio! Incendio!
Incendio was right. The whole plane was a ball of fire. And inside, I was hanging head down, suspended by my safety belt. Those Mexicans were brave men. They got through the shattered window of the cockpit, clawing through the tangle of wire, choking with the smoke, burning themselves. But they got me out, pulled me through the window, and I got cut bad on the broken glass. But at least I was able to walk away from the plane under my own power, far enough away before the old crate blew. That was that. The last of my plane. The last of my money. The last of my plans for my own air cargo line. The last of my hopes. Or so I thought. I was despairing. A condition refueled constantly through my hours of fitful sleep. I replayed that horrible event over and over in my dreams for years after. It followed me back to Hollywood, into the cheap apartments where I lived, and right into the bars where I tried to drown the memory, but didn't succeed. Drinking didn't help, regardless of how much I drank or how drunk I got. Like the night I came staggering out of Pier No Place, a joint on Sunset Strip. The car jock gunned my old sports car up to the curb.
Evening, Mr. Marius. You feel okay to drive?
I feel great. Yeah. Hey, something new has been added.
Since you was a friend of yours, I just wanted to wait in your car.
I've been waiting a long time. Good evening, James.
She smiled at me from where she lounged down and back in the passenger seat. A slow, easy smile showing small white teeth, a casual curving of her lips like a cat's. Her hair was silver gilt and edged with indigo from the neon side outside Pier No Place. I put the car in gear and moved out into the stream of traffic.
You're going in the wrong direction.
Wrong direction from where?
It's not important.
The point, exactly. Once I get to wherever I'm going, I haven't been any place. I don't know you.
I know you.
This is a gag. Who put you up to it?
My own idea.
I'll drive you to the Roosevelt. You can get a cab there.
I'm not ready to take a cab. I picked you up. Not for the reason you're probably thinking.
Not thinking much of anything right now. Except it's after 2. I had a date at 10. It's a little late.
You don't want to keep it. If you do, you're going to disappoint me. Look what I brought. A bottle of champagne and one of brandy. I hope you can help me drink it.
Hey, look, I live here. Have for quite a while. I'm no sucker for a setup.
You don't have enough money to make setting you up, as you put it, worthwhile. I've been to a lot of trouble finding you, Marius. Come on. Let's be pleasant and celebrate my success. Please?
Why'd you try to find me?
Because I think you're the kind of a man I'd like to know.
That's not a reason. That's a lie.
That's the truth. Hey, don't look so suspicious.
I am suspicious. A girl who looks like you doesn't usually just appear in a parking lot.
It could almost be a compliment.
What's your name?
Lucille Jackson. My friends call me Lou. Well, now that we've been introduced, where shall we go to have our drinks? My place or yours?
Mine.
Still suspicious?
Yes.
All right. Well, go to yours.
I swung the car off Sunset Boulevard La Brea and cut up Franklin, turned on Highland and headed north toward the Hollywood Bowl. Just before the bowl, I pulled into the drive of the old Mediterranean Spanish-style apartment building where I lived. I parked in the back. She brought the paper bag of bottles. We entered the patio from a rear archway and walked along the side of a pool to my door at the far end. Inside, I turned on the light. And for the first time, I really saw her. Very tall, slender, with a centuries-old, eternally mysterious smile of feminine knowledge, wisdom, amusement on her lips. She wore black pants and a black silk blouse. A black cat.
I'll open the brandy while you uncork the champagne.
Here are the glasses. Lou Jackson? Sounds like every name I've ever heard. Should I know it?
No reason you should. Let's drink a toast.
It's your liquor. What'll it be?
To your luck, James Marius. It's going to change.
I'll drink to that. What do you know about my luck?
It hasn't been good. But at least you've been willing to try.
Have I?
Mm-hmm. That's one reason I like you.
To what do I owe this honor? When should you pick on me?
Well, one night I saw you at a party.
What party?
It isn't important. You didn't see me. You were even more drunk than you are now. I asked who you were and found out.
And so you couldn't resist me. You're putting me on. I don't believe it.
Here I am.
Yeah. Maybe. Well, I'm going to bed now.
If that's an invitation, I accept.
When I woke up, the room was bright. It had to be noon or later. I had an awful hangover. It took me a few minutes to remember the night before and Lou Jackson. I saw the empty bottles. They were there, but she was gone. And what else? I groped my way over to my clothes, heaped in a pile on a chair, and went through my trousers. My billfold was missing. I'd been taken, like a naive, chumpetic invention. It made me sick. Sicker than I was to realize I'd lost my money, driver's license, everything. Everything but credit cards. I didn't own any. Hello.
Hello, James. This is Lou. Surprised?
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't expect to hear from you again.
You missed your billfold?
Some time ago.
I have it.
I guess then.
I called to tell you you could have it back. When I took it, I had no intention of keeping it.
Well, why'd you take it?
Because I wanted to see you again. I thought you'd drive over to my place and pick it up. Last night, you were so cautious, so suspicious. I wanted to prove that I could have taken your money if that had been my plan. Now you see it wasn't, don't you?
I can't drive without my license.
You think it's too dangerous?
I'll be over. Where do you live? Lou gave me her address in a section of Hollywood near Hollywood Boulevard and Sunset, just east of what used to be the old Columbia Studios. Her apartment was 2C.
Come on, Marius.
To my sober eyes in the flat light of the afternoon, Lou was not so young as I remembered. She was in her 30s, 35 maybe, but still beautiful. More beautiful, probably, than when she'd been younger. Her hair seemed to change from silver to gold, and back to silver again, to match the transparent gray of her eyes with their great black pupils. I looked around. The apartment was a typical Hollywood furnished deal, matching drapes and carpet, run-of-the-mill semi-modern furniture. Its only escape from mediocrity was a large oil painting, 4 feet wide, and nearly 6 feet high, the draped figure of a young woman nude to her waist. Anyone I know?
No, I don't know her either.
Did it come in the apartment?
It belongs to me. Do you like it?
Who's it by? It's signed D-E-S-T-O. Desto?
I think it's Gazzetti. He doesn't write so well as he paints. Anyway, he isn't well known. Like a drink? Margarita? I love him.
Yeah, I need something.
Be right back.
When I sat down in one of the cushioned chairs, I felt something under my hip. It was an envelope, the size and shape of business correspondence, addressed to L. Jackson. The return address was Rothman Associates on Western Avenue in Hollywood. I placed the envelope on the coffee table as Lou came back with the margaritas.
Here. First for today.
The first... Well, it's still pretty early, but I'll go along. That's my trouble. I always go along. But good.
Are you warning me that you're head drunk?
Some citizens might say I am. I didn't used to be. You're lovely. And the drinks are good. The apartment is cool and quiet. I should be happy, but I'm not.
Why?
Because last night you picked me up for a reason. And I can't figure it out. We don't know each other.
I know quite a bit about you. Once, you were a good flyer. You crashed, went broke, you tried land speculation, and that folded. What was left, you shot in Vegas. More?
Is there?
Quite a bit. You owned a piece of the Ketch Playgirl, which sank the Trans-Pac race to Hawaii, and finally, strictly for money, you tried a few stunt jobs and pictures. You were nearly killed, but this time you collected some insurance, and that's what you've been living on.
Huh. Doesn't sound like much of a success story. Now, if you don't mind, I'll have another drink.
Sit.
Please.
I also know you're 35. Married and divorced once?
No, only partly, right. I've been married, but not divorced. My wife committed suicide right in the middle of the proceedings.
Oh? Did you love her? Oh, here.
Thanks. Yes, I loved her.
Did she love you?
Well, there must have been something she loved more. You researched me, but you hadn't answered my question. Why this interest in me?
I'll tell you. Because you're a gambler, willing to take a chance. I need a man like that in my life.
No, wait, I'm...
You think you're unlucky, had all the bad breaks. But the truth is, you are lucky. What's happened to you would have killed the average man a couple of times. And next time, you'll strike it really big. I know. Believe me, I know.
Times we had. The ordinary little apartment with drawn drapes holding the soft half-light of a marine grotto. Outside the window, the fronds of a palm rustling in the darkness. Was it that night? Or the next, or the one following that? Time meant nothing. The telescope said that all the wonderful tomorrows were suddenly now. I had told Lou she was lovely, but I was wrong. She was beautiful. It was all so beautiful. Maybe my luck was changing like she said it would. I was falling for her hard. I wanted her. I wanted to know all about her. Tell me, Lou, what are you doing here? I mean, what do you do?
Nothing, just living. My father left me a little money. I get by. You're looking very solemn again.
Just thinking. Wish I knew more about you.
Is that necessary? All women, any woman, will tell you only what she wants you to know. Not deliberately lying, perhaps, but changing things in her memory the way she wished they'd happened, or might have been. So you see, at best, it's not the truth, but only an impression. An impression of herself as she tells it. I could tell you that when I was a little girl, there were so many things I wanted and never had.
You never married?
No. Nope. I nearly did, once. Then I backed out.
Who was he?
Can't we just drink and be in love and happy to know each other? Does everything have to be put into words and explained and talked away? Let's you and I just be lovers.
The days edged into each other, weeks overlapped, but it was always tomorrow. I went back to my own apartment, but Lou and I had built up a lovely routine. She filled my nights as full as, well, sex and liquor can make an addict of any man, and I didn't escape. And yet, I was always assailed by doubt. Doubt that tonight she would fail to arrive. I was frightened that she might drop out of my life as suddenly as she had appeared. She was under no obligation to me, owed me nothing. Always, however, she did come. I'd take her in my arms, and our night would begin. Tomorrow was another day. But the day finally came when the last of my money ran out. My checking account was empty. The liquor, my apartment, even my car would have to go. Tomorrow had finally arrived. I couldn't endure the prospect of life without Lou. I couldn't give her up. She had never discussed marriage, never demanded it, but keep her I must, on any terms.
Waiting?
I'm always waiting.
You look so glum.
Do I? Well, come on in. Maybe a drink will pick me up. Lou, there's something that I have to tell you.
Oh?
I'm broke. Except for a few bucks in my pocket, I have nothing in the bank or anyplace else.
What are your plans?
I don't know. Nothing for me around here. I used to have a good friend in Chicago. Perhaps he can line me up a job back there.
Have you written to him?
No, not yet. I wanted to tell you first. Now, if I go back, Will you come with me? We'll get married.
No. Darling, I love you. You must understand that.
I don't
understand. Then listen. Listen to me for a moment. I do love you. And I will marry you, but I won't do it like this. Beaten down, creeping off to Chicago on our knees to live off a handout from a friend.
Well, that's better than living on county charity.
Is it?
Well, what do you suggest?
Well, it's not clear to me either. At least, not right now, but it must involve a lot of money, and it should take brains, or someone else would have done it. There has to be the element of risk. Let me think about it. Somewhere in the back of my mind, there is an idea. Only a passing thought, really.
Sit down, we'll talk about it. Please, look, it's still early. You don't have to go now.
Good night, darling. I'll call you tomorrow when I know more.
Know more about what?
Money, love. Lots of it. At least, all we'd need to be happy together.
Please stay. I want you to stay.
Afraid I'll leave you because you're broke?
No, no, that's not it.
Oh, risk it, Marius. It's a good gamble. You can't lose.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Fourth of Forever. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. James Marius, one man alone, with a passion for gambling, a dependence upon alcohol, and a desire for one woman. Lou Jackson, one woman. A woman who knows what she wants and what's necessary to do to get it. They met in a parking lot on the Sunset Strip. The right place, the right time. For James Marius, the desire has become an obsession. But the obsession has left him penniless and vulnerable. For Lou Jackson, this is a man primed for action, not afraid to take a risk. A risk she is now prepared to ask him to take. The stakes must be high and the odds long. The reward James Marius will seek is nothing short of forever. Fourth of Forever continues in a moment.
I slept very little that night. My nightmare replayed in living color. All the next morning I was tense, anxious, filled with an almost evil foreboding. And yet, I couldn't help thinking about the fortune Lou had half promised. She phoned me in the afternoon. Her voice was warm and easy as always. She suggested we meet for a drink at Pernod Place. In a way, it was sort of ironic. We had first met there when I was in the depths, and now it seemed our second meeting might rocket me to new heights. Waiting long?
Just got here. Sit down, darling.
I missed you. All night.
You wondered why I left?
Understatement. Waiter, two scotches on the rocks.
Remember what we were discussing? Yeah. I used to know a girl named Clara. No glamour puss, no sharp cookie, actually. She's pretty dull.
Yeah.
I first met her when I came out here. Clara's a secretary, private secretary to a rich real estate man, Theodore Warren, Ted Warren. Ever heard of him?
Maybe the name's familiar.
Well, Clara has no life of her own, no men, not much of anything. So she's built her whole life around her boss, all she can talk about. She takes care, but really, of all the details for him. Whenever we met for lunch, she'd tell me every little thing. Frankly, it was a bore. I couldn't have cared less.
Why did you keep on seeing her then?
I felt sorry for her, I suppose. Anyhow, her boss, Ted Warren, has lots of irons in the fire. He goes to New York every month or two and takes huge amounts of cash with him. Well, part in cash, part in negotiable stocks and bonds. Don't you think that's rather odd?
Well, it takes a week to 10 days for a check to clear between Los Angeles and New York. Maybe he uses the money for down payments, guarantees, possibly performance bonds.
That might be it. Anyway, Mr. Warren, I gather, is a bit of an old toad. Always stays at the same hotel, same suite. He likes a particular view of the park.
You're building up to something. What?
Why don't you get that money the next time Warren goes to New York?
There it was. All laid out on the table. I couldn't believe it as I stared across the table at Lou, her soft face, her aura of gentleness.
I can get all the details from Clara. She won't even know I'm asking. She'd never suspect me.
What about Warren?
What about him? He doesn't know you from Adam.
Still, but couldn't he make the connection between Clara and you?
Maybe, but by that time, we'll be so far away from here, they'll never find us.
If I go to New York, it'll take money just to get there.
Oh, I thought of that. Here is a cashier's check. $1,000. It's nearly the last of what I have. We're in this together, darling. Let's drink to it.
That next week, Lou renewed her friendship with Clara. They met for lunch nearly every day at exactly 12 noon. Lou had come to my apartment in the evening with a bottle and the latest information. On Thursday, when I heard her footsteps coming through the patio, I knew that Lou had news to relay that would finally be useful.
Oh, love, good news. Warren's going to New York on the 23rd.
Oh, that doesn't leave us much time.
There's more. Let's go inside. He's got a reservation on Transcontinental Airlines flight 171 for the 23rd.
That's Wednesday.
Mm-hmm. He arrives at 9:36 New York time.
Kennedy Airport?
No, Newark. And he'll take a taxi from there to the Park Hamilton in Manhattan.
Well, what about the money?
Stays right in his room, in a briefcase. And that's where you'll relieve him of it.
What about a gun?
Doesn't own one. Clara says he hates loud noises. Warren must be a real ringer.
No gun. Still, I'll need one.
Do you have a gun?
I can get one.
How?
I'll tell you later. The following morning, I went out to a studio where a director friend of mine was shooting a picture. On the soundstage, I managed to lift a revolver from the props. Smith & Wesson 38. It was easy. Next, I needed bullets. I bought them in the black market on Sunset. Then I got Warren's business address from the Yellow Pages. Dressed in a pair of coveralls like maintenance servicemen wear and with an assortment of plastic alphabet letters, I took up a position in the corridor outside the doors of Warren's office. I pretended to make adjustments on the building's board while I waited for Warren to leave for lunch, promptly at 12. Lou had told me that he usually carried an expensive alligator briefcase. I glanced at my watch. 1 minute of.
Down.
It was a man with a briefcase, but I wasn't positive the man was Warren. The time was right, and he carried a briefcase, but he was younger than I thought he'd be. I went through the heavy walnut panel doors, which were lettered in gold. Theodore K. Warren, Realty. A young, pretty receptionist was seated behind a desk.
Yes?
Is Mr. Warren in?
Who shall I say is calling?
From the garage.
Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Warren just left for lunch.
Oh. Well, was that him getting on the elevator when I got off wearing a dark suit? Carrying a briefcase?
Must have been. He hasn't been gone 2 minutes.
Here you are, darling. You're worried about something.
I got a look at Ted Warren. Have you ever seen him?
No, all I know about him is what Clara's told me.
What Clara's told you isn't quite true. Warren's not the little toad he is supposed to be. But that's not what worries me.
What is it, then?
If Clara gives you a wrong description about how Warren looks, why can't she be wrong about a lot of other things we're depending on?
Oh, I wouldn't worry. Clara may have described Warren as a doddering, puttering little old man that depends on her just to make herself feel more important. But fact, business facts, oh, she couldn't make a mistake about them.
I hope not.
Stop worrying, darling. Just think about us. I guarantee it'll work.
The afternoon of Tuesday, the 22nd, Lou came to my apartment. I left my car parked there. She drove me to the airport. On the way, we went over the plan. Warren will check into the Park Hamilton Suite 1220 around 10:45. At 11, he should be getting ready for bed. And that's when I hit him. I'll get the money and be out of the hotel by 10 after 11. I'll have a cab waiting to take me to LaGuardia Airport in time to catch the 12:30 flight to L.A.
Right. Now, if something goes wrong and you don't catch it...
Well, I'll wait for the next flight.
Where will you stay tonight?
I'll find a hotel near the Park Hamilton. And tomorrow during the day, I'll get a look at Warren's suite. Locate the doors, windows, exits, elevators, and so on. Tomorrow night, when he arrives, I'll be ready. On the flight to New York, I still had doubts. I realized I was taking a calculated risk and was banking on my strength and nerves to mesh correctly with time, place, and circumstances to gain a fortune. But I wasn't sure. I still had the guts to pull it off. I wasn't a coward. I never have been. But now I was trying to be honest. The cold fact was, I didn't want to rob Warren. It was Lou who had put me on the plane, winging closer each minute to New York. It was this very weakness in submitting to Lou that made me doubt myself. My memory of those desolate years of loneliness and despair before I met Lou was my greatest enemy. I couldn't fight the future she'd brought me, a green oasis of hope.
We will be landing in New York City in approximately 20 minutes. We hope you've enjoyed your flight.
I registered in a small hotel, the Shropshire, under the name of Howard Morgan. It was only a couple of blocks from the Park Hamilton. The next morning, I slept late, had breakfast, then strolled over to familiarize myself with the layout of Warren's hotel. It had three entrances, one on 59th Street and two around the corner on 5th Avenue. The streets were narrow and congested and could easily be traffic traps, so I decided against the taxi for my escape. Instead, I'd walk over to 59th and Madison to catch a cab to the airport. The lobby of the Park Hamilton was big, ornate, with acres of green carpeting and vast walls of antique mirrored glass. It was possible to enter the hotel and go to the elevators without passing the registration desk, so I took one to the 10th floor. Most hotel rooms are numbered identically as the floors ascend. In other words, Suite 1020 would probably be the same layout as 1220, where Warren would stay. 1020 had a main door opening on the broad corridor running parallel to 5th Avenue. There was a secondary entrance and a small corridor around the corner. I decided this second door led to either a service pantry or a back bedroom. Next to it was a stairway encased in a firewall. I climbed it, two floors, and found myself standing outside the service door of Suite 1220. The layout of the two suites was identical. So I returned by the stairs again to the 10th floor, where I caught the elevator to the lobby. Then I left the hotel. I went to a drugstore and bought copper wire, adhesive tape, and a pair of women's nylons. I'd used one of them for a face mask. I passed the rest of that interminable day waiting for the inevitable night, thinking about Lou, about our future together, with enough money to live in style. I worked out in my mind how it would be when I confronted Warren. He would answer the door. I'd hold him at the point of my revolver, bind his hands with wire, and tape his mouth shut. Then lock him in a closet. It'd take him at least 10 minutes to get free. If he put up a fight, I'd smack him with a gun, knock him unconscious. At 11 o'clock, I left the bar in the Shropshire. I wasn't drunk. I returned to my room, got my gun, and the rest of what I'd need. Then I started for the Park Hamilton and Ted Warren. I stopped behind the metal door of the fire well on the 12th floor. There I took off my top coat, folded it, and placed it on the floor just inside the door. The wire and tape were in my pockets. Pulling a nylon over my face, I checked my gun and stepped out into the hall. For a moment, I stared at the door. 12:20. This was the point of no return.
Who's there?
Mr. Warren? Say, I'm sorry to disturb you. I'm from maintenance.
What the hell's that?
There's a short on this floor. I gotta check the lights.
Oh, hurry it up. I'm getting ready for bed.
As soon as I saw the door crack open, I slammed it back on him with all my might and knocked him halfway across the room. He was wearing an open dressing gown and pajama pants. Behind him, a hall led to a darkened bedroom. A mirror in the hall reflected the open door. Though I had the revolver pointed at his chest, he appeared more angry than frightened.
What do you want?
The money, Mr. Warren.
My wallet? You're welcome to.
You know what I mean? Where's the briefcase?
You won't shoot. You'd never make it out of the hotel.
Just shut up. And give me the damn briefcase.
It's over in the bureau.
Get it?
All right.
And keep your hands where I can see them. Warren went to the bureau, took out the briefcase, and came back, holding it in front of him. Then, he shot me from behind his briefcase. I fell back. My right arm jerked up with pain. I saw the reflection of the flame from my revolver in the mirror before the bedroom. Warren pitched forward to the floor. I didn't stop for the briefcase or anything. I just turned and ran. In the fire well by the stairs, I realized I had dropped my revolver in the suite, but I couldn't go back. Warren was wounded, but he still had his gun. He was probably on the phone calling for help at that very moment. Blood was dripping from my arm, running down my wrist and spattering the concrete stairs. I grabbed my top coat and started down, leaving a red trail behind me. At the mezzanine floor, just above the lobby, I stopped again. I yanked off the nylon mask and struggled out of my jacket. Rolling up the sleeve of my shirt, I looked at the wound. The bullet was lodged in the muscle of my right arm, a few inches above the elbow. I knew it had to come out, and soon. I wrapped a piece of the soft copper wire around my arm above the wound, twisting it into a tourniquet to stem the flow of blood. Then I bit into the tape, tore off a strip, and plastered it over the nylon to make a bandage. By now, my arm was stiff and throbbing. I had a tough time getting back into my jacket. I swung the top coat over my shoulders, leaving it to hang free, and covered my wounded arm, which I stuffed in my jacket pocket for support. Then I descended the fire well to the lobby. I opened the metal door to the fire well and peered out. I could see across the lobby. Everything seemed normal. But just then, two men, unmistakably detectives, accompanied by a cop in uniform, came in the Fifth Avenue entrance and walked briskly to the registration desk. Whatever they said caused the desk clerk to start in surprise, and he hurriedly called the night manager. Then it went into a huddle, then the manager and the two plainclothesmen headed for the elevators. The uniformed cop stayed at the desk and looked over the lobby. I didn't wait. Forcing myself to stroll casually, I made it to the 59th Street entrance. Ignoring the doorman's offer to get me a cab, I headed down 59th Street toward Madison Avenue. At the corner of Madison, I flagged down a taxi and got in.
Where to, Mac?
What time is it?
11:30.
It's too late to catch my flight.
So? All right, what next?
Penn Station.
On our way.
I didn't go to the station. I knew there'd be an APB out for a wounded man at all railroad stations, airports, bus depots, even ship terminals. I got out at 37th Street. Down the block, I saw a cut-rate drugstore and headed for it, self-service. I picked up a cheap canvas suitcase, bottle of iodine, roll of cotton, a box of cleaning tissue, a razor, and cheesy orange sports shirt, the only one in the store that would fit me. A cashier with hair headed about the color of my new shirt checked me out with a comment about my hand. The whole right side of my body was stiffening up, and I told her I had arthritis in my shoulder. And she told me her husband had arthritis, and that was that. I walked aimlessly down the street, my mind fuzzy with shock and fatigue. But I had to find a place to stay the night. I had to get off the streets before I was picked up. A liquor store was closing for the night, but I had caught it in time to buy a bottle of whiskey. 100 proof. By now, my arm was pulsating in a deadly, heavy rhythm. My sense of balance dipped and whirled. I fought to remain conscious. In desperation, I hailed another cab.
You drunk?
No. No. Sick.
Won't drive it drunk, but if you're just sick, buddy, I'll take you. Hospital?
Not the hospital. Stranger in town. Just got in. Take me to his hotel. I just want to go to bed.
Which hotel?
Anyone. Just so it isn't midtown.
Some down near the village.
Okay. The Archway Hotel is located on East 9th Street. It's small and secluded, with miserable little potted trees on each side of the entrance. The desk clerk watched me full of doubts and suspicion. I registered awkwardly with my left hand, signing under the name of Seaton. I explained to him that I had smashed my right hand on the train. He looked relieved and showed me my room. As soon as he was gone, I threw myself on the bed and opened a suitcase. The world was spinning like a gyroscope. I pulled out the bottle, worked the cap free with my teeth, and I took a pull. The whiskey ran down my chin and dripped to my chest. My worst fears had been realized. Clara's information, like her description, had been wrong. I fell asleep holding the bottle in my belly, thinking about Lou and the future we'd lost.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Fourth of Forever. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Wrigley Gum Sign-Off and Ford Motor Company. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow. And once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Radio Network.